Sin City. It's pressing your luck.
Go! Did he handle it up into the wall?
If it does, we're going for it. We're a lap and a half short.
He can afford to be a little bit crazy and take some chances.
It's rolling the dice.
Into the outside wall, Kyle Busch.
Here comes Kevin Harvick.
I can't believe it. We're out of gas.
The emotion in the pits.
It's going all in.
Peters to the bottom of the racetrack. Now they're three wide for the lead.
Oh, the lead is.
Both of them sideways.
To hit the jackpot or go home empty-handed.
He is not happy with the two of Elliott Sadler.
Oh, the side out.
It goes Todd Bodine.
It's Las Vegas, baby. And it starts now on Speed.
From the collector cars of Barrett Jackson on the Las Vegas Strip to the over 600 horsepower producing Camping World trucks at the Las Vegas Motor Speedway. Speed keeps you on the edge of your seat for 146 laps of side-by-side racing. Welcome to the NASCAR Camping World Truck Series Smith's Food and Drug Stores 350 on Speed. The temperature has dropped to 97 degrees. It was triple digits earlier this afternoon. Forecast for clear skies, no precipitation. We're going to have great racing weather tonight. 19 races into this season, and Todd Bodine has a 257-point lead over Eric Almirola. He is not going to win the championship. It's actually in his hands now. He will have to falter. For more on what you need to know before this race starts, let's go to Ray Dunlap.
Well, thank you, Rick. You know, we've run 13 races here at the Las Vegas Motor Speedway, and 10 of the winners have come from the first five qualifiers. Now, there's a very good chance that Todd Bodine's going to be good tonight. He's won more races on mile and a half than anyone. Johnny Sauter won here a year ago. Matt Crafton has been oh so close to getting a victory again this season. And up front, how about James Buescher? Almost won in the very last race. Austin Dillon with his fifth pole this season. My prediction tonight here at Las Vegas is the winner in this race will have a number three in their door number. Adam?
Ray, Kyle Busch has been on a roll in the Camping World Truck Series of late, winning three of the last four races, and he put his name in the NASCAR history books earlier today, winning his 11th Nationwide Series race of the season. Tonight, Brian Eichler takes the spot in the 18 truck, and he tries to continue this magical ride. Rick?
Thanks, guys. We will keep our eyes on those guys tonight in this race. Right now, let's go back to the start-finish line for our pre-race ceremonies.
All right, once again, good evening. Welcome to Las Vegas for tonight's Smith's Food and Drug at 350. Ladies and gentlemen, please rise as the Nellis Air Base Honor Guard presents our nation's colors. Gentlemen, please remove your hats. As the colors are presented, gentlemen, please remain standing for the invocation presented by LVMS Chaplain Joe Freiberger.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for a beautiful evening for racing. Lord, bless these drivers while they're out on the track. Grant wisdom to their crew and protect the fire and safety personnel. And grant prosperity to the sponsors of this race. And Lord, we ask a special blessing for the brave men and women who defend this great nation of ours. It's in your name that we pray. Amen.
Ladies and gentlemen, please remain standing for our national anthem, sung by Strawberry Blonde.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming.
Yeah!
Great crowd on hand. The drivers are going to be climbing into their trucks and getting strapped in for 146 laps here at Las Vegas Motor Speedway. Hello, everyone. Rick Allen, Phil Parsons, Michael Waltrip with you once again. And this is our 14th visit to Las Vegas Motor Speedway. You always tell me that the last five are the only ones that count because of the reconfiguration. What does it take to win at this racetrack, Phil?
Well, this is a very fast racetrack, so you have to have a lot of horsepower. But I think the truck that's going to win this race tonight is the one that's going to keep that handle longer. They practiced during the daytime, Michael. They didn't practice in this as it cools off like it is tonight. But they have to have a good handling package. They can run wide open on new tires. But as the tires wear down, they're going to slow down some. And the guy with the best handling package will be the one in victory lane tonight.
And we're in Vegas, right? You got to be lucky. And everyone in this field is lucky right now because Kyle Busch and Kevin Harvick are up in Dover, Delaware. So that means we're going to have a wide open race to see who can take Vegas tonight, and it's going to be fun to watch.
Could be one of the truck regulars, obviously, that will make it to victory lane tonight. Now, we just got done with 21 and a half hours of Barrett Jackson collector car auction right here on Speed. Well, we've got a couple guys right here in the truck series who are car collectors themselves. Maybe we'll have the Skinner Hornaday car collection auto auction one day. Let's take a look.
These are three of, actually two are my cars and one of my father-in-law's. I kind of started with my Chevelle first just because of all the years of racing. I cut cars apart and cut the fender wells out and put big tires and raced them there at my local track Saga. So this one actually came from Larry Gunsum and he got it from Ricky Craven. So it's been sitting in his barn for about 10 years, and I got it, and first car I restored. So we put a 502 in it from Chevrolet, and year one helped me with all the parts on it.
This is a 1991 454 SS Chevrolet truck. A really, really close friend of mine, Don Butler, owns this truck. And I was at his house one day, and I said, Don, I said, if you ever get rid of that truck, I want that truck. If anything ever happens to you, I want the truck. A couple years later, he showed up with it in Daytona. The truck's got 200 miles on it. It still has the original plastic on the seat.
Pretty hard to find an El Camino. This is a 66 El Camino. I wanted one because I always went to school. A buddy of mine, Jim Rollins, I rode to school in his El Camino. It was always fun because we'd stash our books under the back seat and you keep losing them. So it was always a good excuse not to do all your homework.
This is a 55 Ford F100. One of my good friends that gave me one of my very first jobs, Lee Hunter, bought this truck brand new in 1955. One night in my mom's tavern, the guy was trying to buy the truck from him. And Lee said, no, I'd rather give it to that kid over there. I think I was like 14 years old at the time. So Lee says, Mike, come over here. He says, do you promise that you will keep this truck in your family forever if I give it to you? And I said, hell yeah, absolutely. I'll keep it if you're going to give it to me. And he handed the title to me.
That car right there is 99% all original. We kind of cloned it at the 73, but we cloned it at the 70. We took all the 5 mile an hour bumpers off and did that. This car here, with air conditioning, was probably about $2,800 off the showroom floor. Depending what motor you put in them, or if it's a matching number car, you can actually, at Barrett Jackson, you probably get anywhere from $40,000 to
$80,000. My Camaro, I wish I could drive it every day, but it is a Barrett Jackson car. It's a 69 RSSS. It's pretty rare. I think this was the coolest Camaro ever built. It's my favorite car. You know, this car here, a couple years ago, I was seeing them go for $180,000 to $210,000, $220,000 at Barrett Jackson. And I don't know if it's that strong now, but it's going to stay in my family till it gets at least that strong again. Then, you know, they'd run for a shortage of them. They know where one's at.
Barrett Jackson, an awesome auction taking place here in Las Vegas the past 3 days. Over 505 cars sold, $20 million for all of the vehicles sold in that auto auction. An amazing time here in Las Vegas. And of course, Speed has all of the Barrett Jackson auto auctions. If you enjoyed this one, our next one is in Scottsdale, Arizona. That is in 2011, right at the beginning. January 17th through the 23rd. It's the 40th Barrett Jackson Collectors Auto Auction. How about the fact Ron Hornaday mentioned that if you had an El Camino, you didn't have to do all your homework? I picked up on that right away.
What about Mike Skinner hanging around with guys that gives cars away? I didn't have anything like that going on back in Kentucky, I'll tell you that.
Well, there were some great cars. We actually spent a couple days over at the auto auction here in Las Vegas, an incredible amount of nice vehicles.
Yeah, pretty amazing showing there once again for the Barrett Jackson Auto Auction. Now let's get the engines fired.
Please
here at Las
Vegas
Motor Speedway. We go down for the command.
Ladies and gentlemen, Holly Madison for the most famous words in NASCAR.
Madison gave the command, and of course, everybody fired their engines right up. 36 trucks have come to life here at Las Vegas Motor Speedway. When in Las Vegas, maybe sometimes you have to gamble. How will the cards fall tonight at Las Vegas Motor Speedway, or will someone crap out? You're about to find out here. We'll be back with more right here on Speed from Las Vegas. The NASCAR Camping World Truck Series on Speed is brought to you by Camping World. Visit Camping World RV Sales to check out their huge diesel motorhome inventory. More affordable than you think. By AARP's Auto and Home Insurance Program from The Hartford. And by Toyota. And again, welcome back to Las Vegas, Nevada, Sin City. What a gorgeous evening it is. About sunset here in the area. The Strip, just about 13 miles south of us here at the racetrack. Our starting grid will roll across the bottom of the screen. Out front of this field tonight will be Austin Dillon. Hits his fifth career pole. He received that earlier tonight. And then he is the only rookie to score five poles in a season. So he's got a role going here in the Truck Series. Let's take a look at our Z-Max track description.
What a great racetrack here. They reconfigured this back for the 2006 race. It went from 12 degrees in the corners to 20 degrees, and now we have multiple racing grooves around this place, Michael.
You know, when they throw the green flag field, the thing that's tough is running side by side in these high bank turns. These trucks are going to be crazy loose at the start. If these guys just can survive the first five or six laps, they can settle in and have some fun. But at first, it's going to be challenging.
Our Royal Purple race analysis, 36 trucks starting this one, 146 laps.
Here, the purse is just under $500,000 in our pit window, somewhere around 55 to 60 laps.
And I think that could be key to winning this race, Phil. These tires don't fall off much here at Las Vegas. You can carry speed on throughout a run, so we could see some strategy late in the going that'll make the difference between getting to victory lane or not.
Always exciting to watch the trucks run under the lights at Las Vegas Motor Speedway. We're going to shine a spotlight on a few different drivers. Tonight, we've got a K&N Pro Series flavor to this field. Ray Dunlap.
Well, Rick, I want to start out with the 18 truck. That's Brian Eichler. You know, his career began out here in the desert in off-road trucks. But when he went to stock cars, he had a lot of success in the K&N Pro Series. Three wins in the West Division and four in the East. But tonight is his last truck race of the season. Kyle Busch will be back for the last five races, and Brian Eichler believes he's got a real legitimate shot of taking that M&M's Toyota to victory lane here in Vegas. Adam?
So Brian Eichler making his last start of the year. This young man making his career debut. We're talking about David Mayhew in the 19. He will roll from the 23rd position. Currently second in the K&N Pro Series West point standings. He's from Bakersfield, California, just like Kevin Harvick. In fact, he made his NASCAR debut driving for Harvick in the Nationwide Series when he practiced his car at Iowa earlier this season. They really like this kid. This is one of Harvick's trucks, and he feels like he can be very successful here tonight. Phil?
Adam, let's take a look at the number 62 Chevy of Greg Pursley. Greg's a West Coaster who cut his teeth in the NASCAR Weekly Racing Series. He won the national championship back in 2004. And he also won the super late model portion of the Toyota All-Star Showdown in 2007. Greg finished third in points last year in the K&N Pro Series West Division. He just won his second race of his career in that series 2 weeks ago on the road course in Tooele, Utah. He made his Truck Series debut earlier this year in Iowa and came away with an eighth place finish. We'll see him again when we visit Phoenix later this year. He starts the StarNursery.com Chevy from the 14th position, Mikey.
Phil, let's look at Jason Bowles. This 27-year-old from Ontario, California is making his NASCAR Camping World Truck Series debut. He'll be driving one of Bob Germain, the Germain brothers Toyota. That means that Jason has a teammate. Todd Bodine is that teammate, and Todd's fast, right? Well, so is Jason. In 2009, he was the K&N West Series champion. JB rolls off 20th in that Toyota.
Michael, you mentioned a champion in the K&N Pro Series. Congratulations to you. Earlier today, it was locked up, your second K&N Pro Series East Championship with Ryan Truex.
Yeah, I'm proud of Mike Greachy, Ryan Truex, all the boys, Fuzz, that worked so hard on that car. I mean, they're a winning organization. That's 2 years in a row, their first two years in the K&N Series, and they win the championship. Ryan's obviously progressing nicely, running some nationwide races this year, and will continue to do that throughout the end of the season.
We're going to ride along with a few different trucks tonight, one of those being Mario Gosselin. He will start in the 26th position. We will ride along not only in the cab, but we've got a camera on top of his truck. We'll be able to see the vantage point of how he gets through this field.
We're also going to ride along with Jay White, Jason White's in the GunBroker.com Dodge. Jason had his best career finish here in this race last year when he finished third. Problem is he blew an engine in practice. He's going to have to go to the back of the field to start this thing. He was scheduled to start from the 15th position.
Phil, my guy's Todd Bodine. He's right up front, starting from the fifth place in the Toyota onboard camera. He rolls off fifth, like I said, and he always is good for some good stuff from inside his truck.
Johnny Sauter won the race a year ago. We'll ride along with him. He starts in the fourth position. Now let's go back trackside to Ray Dunlap.
Well, thanks, Rick. You know, I want to take a look at the guys who have won big races on the mile and a half. So, of course, Todd Bodine clear at the top of that list with 12 victories. So, you know, he's going to be good here tonight. And in 2005, he won with a last lap pass. Skinner has two wins at this racetrack and Hornaday five top five. So I think those guys could be a big factor tonight, especially the Valvoline Toyota. Adam?
And one thing they all have in common, Ray, is they are veterans. There is one rookie in the field tonight who has his sights set on victory lane. We're talking about Austin Dillon. It has been an amazing rookie campaign for driver number three. He recorded a career best fifth pole of the season earlier today. That's best by rookies all time in the Camping World Truck Series. He has that win at Iowa, 13 top 10 finishes. He would love to get his second victory here tonight. Rick?
Thanks, guys. And amazingly enough, Austin Dillon, just 20 years old. He became the youngest pole winner at Las Vegas Motor Speedway earlier today. On his inside, the driver of the 31, well, he's just 20 years old as well. Out of turn number four, we're about to get underway. Green flag in the air.
What a great jump by Austin Dillon. A couple of truck lengths already on the field as they head toward turn one. Great start there.
James Buescher, his ninth top three qualifying effort, yet to get a pole.
How do you do that? You get that close, you'd think one of them would fall your way.
I bet he would trade all of them in for a win tonight. He was so close a week ago in Loudon.
What a great race it was a week ago in Loudon. You know, you thought Kevin Harvick and Kyle Busch were just going to settle that between themselves. And out of nowhere, here comes James Buescher and almost had it stolen from those guys.
Lap number one, side by side for third. But out in front of this field, it's Austin Dillon. Johnny Sauter running second. James Buescher is third. Matt Crafton fourth. Todd Bodine rounds out our top five.
Good battle back there right behind Ron Hornaday in sixth. You see Brian Eichler on the inside. The two truck of Kenny Schrader. Kevin Harvick's normal ride. Kenny Schrader's in that truck. Always finishes in the top 10 when he jumps in that truck.
Ricky Carmichael in the four.
Like I said, Rick, this is the time in the race when these guys are just a little jittery. These trucks aren't really handling all that great right at this moment. The tire pressures are down a little bit, and it's tough to get grip, so they're tiptoeing a little bit.
We had two practices earlier today, then qualifying in the race. Three wide as they cross the stripe. Right in the middle is Eric Almirola. He's able to hold on to it. Justin Lofton on the outside in the seven.
It was Greg Persley, that black truck in the inside, number 62. Look how much we talk about these guys almost running wide open. Look how much momentum Greg Persley lost when he backed off in that three wide situation.
Almirola on the bottom of the racetrack, Lofton on the high side. Almirola has the advantage now. Almirola holding on to the 14th position. Todd Bodine so successful on mile and a half racetracks. Now, a week ago in Loudon, his crew chief injured on pit road during the K&N Pro Series East race, but he is here actually in a wheelchair.
Yeah,
had surgery on his ankle earlier this week.
You knew he'd be here. He got up off the pit road with a broken ankle and came to the racetrack the next day and helped call that race for Todd Bodine. So obviously that was a very gutsy, courageous.
All of those.
I appreciate y'all leaving me hanging there. I knew you were coming with it. I just couldn't get it out of you.
Adam Alexander, how is Johnny Sauter doing?
Well, he's doing good when you look at the numbers. Currently riding in the second position. However, he just came on the radio and said, way too tight, chattering the front tires, to which his crew chief, Joe Shear Jr., replied, everyone's complaining about that. We'll see if he can hang on for the long run, but so far he's been able to maintain that runner-up position on track.
Man, that's bad to have for right off the bat, Phil. You'd want your truck to be just a little loose early in the going, and hopefully it'll tighten up and come to you. If it's tight this quick, that thing will go away on him in a hurry.
Well, Michael, there's a good reason that Austin Dillon is driving away from this battle for second right now. He ran within about a tenth of a second of his pole speed earlier this afternoon. Racetrack is fast.
Yeah, that's something as a race car driver you really don't want to hear. You tell your crew chief you're tight, and they say everybody's tight. Well, you want to say, they're not as tight as me. I promise, they're driving away from me. They can't be as tight as I am. And that's what Johnny Sauter's faced with right now. He's holding up James Buescher. You can tell that's why Austin Dillon's been able to drive away. Plus, Austin's in the best circumstance. He's got all the air on the front of his truck, and he doesn't have anybody on the back of it disturbing the rear end. So he's hauling right now.
We talk so much about that clean air. Right now, Austin Dillon has it.
7th, 8th, 9th, and 10th on your screen. That's Kenny Schrader in the 2 just in front of Brian Eichler in the 18. Then Mike Skinner, who's had success at this racetrack within the past 2 years. One of the things you mentioned, Phil, about the fact that Dillon was running close to what he had run in his pole run, as we see the battle for second on the racetrack. A lot of the drivers talked about the lap times didn't fall off much because of the little harder compound and the tires that they brought here. And so they're able to keep up a consistent pace.
Yeah, and that's why I think it could play out into the strategy you use at the end of this race. You might stay out on four older tires, or you might just get two and try to get some track position. And if a guy like Austin Dillon has a dominant truck, these two might want to mix up their strategy and grab that spot from him.
In this last lap, as we watch this side-by-side battle for second, James Buescher pulls to the outside of Johnny Sauter. That last lap, Austin Dillon beat those two trucks by 8/10 of a second.
James Buescher with a strong run around the outside coming off of turn number 2 takes the spot away from Johnny Sauter. So now Buescher up into second, Sauter back to third. Here's a battle for 8th and 9th.
Yeah, we saw Eichler all over the back of Schrader, and now Skinner's taking that spot away.
Skinner has a mirror full of Brian Eichler in that 18. Seeing them run right down the bottom of this racetrack, right along the white line.
Looks like Skinner's got a good truck tonight, guys. He's able to drive up on the inside of Schrader exiting turn 2. Looks like maybe he can make this move.
You know, Mike Skinner, as he makes that move on Kenny Schrader, he's won on both configurations here at this racetrack. He won a couple years ago in this configuration, and then back on several years ago on the old configuration.
Three drivers have been to victory lane that are in our field today. And as you mentioned, Mike Skinner's won twice. Johnny Sauter won here a year ago. And back in 2005, it was Todd Bodine that went to victory lane. Could we see Austin Dillon get to victory lane tonight? Stay with us. Bright lights of the Las Vegas Strip. One of the brightest lights, the Luxor. Lights up so much that you can see it from the space shuttle when it's in outer space. We've got some lights on here at the track that we didn't want to see. The caution lights have come out.
Greg Pursley lost an engine on that truck down in turns 3 and 4.
NASCAR race day brought by the Home Depot. That's tomorrow at 10 o'clock. Jeff Burton, Kurt Busch, Tony Stewart, Clint Bowyer, Ryan Newman, they'll all join live on that show. Again, the caution lights have come out here at the racetrack, and the reason for that is because we had a problem with the engine expiring.
It's Greg Pursley. That's my spotlight driver right there, coming off a top 10 in his debut at Iowa, and unfortunately going to be a very, very short night for Greg Pursley. We'll see him again in Phoenix here in a few weeks.
That's disappointing, though, man. Like you said, Phil, what a great debut he made out there in Iowa. That truck was fast, and he did just a great job wrestling around all day long.
And, Michael, he was fast in practice.
Yeah.
He was top 5 both practice sessions earlier today.
He would have been a good pick for this race tonight, but unfortunately he goes to the garage early.
We had a couple guys go on to pit road. Let's get an update from Roy Dunlap.
Well, Rick, it seemed a little early, but boy, Ken Schrader did not like his Kroger Chevrolet at all. They came down. He was very, very loose. Put a rubber in the left rear, went down on the track bar, and believe it or not, put 4 tires on it. Schrader said he's got to see if there was a problem with the truck. Also, the 51 of Eric Almirola down here said his truck is completely up on top of the racetrack with absolutely no grip. Adam?
Just a little bit tight for Matt Crafton, but he elected to come down at lap 13 for fuel only and a slight adjustment trying to loosen him up. The thought process there, This track a place where you can have long green flag runs. They thought perhaps later in the race they could stretch the fuel a little further than some other drivers, and perhaps this stop would pay dividends later in the evening.
You know, Michael, that follows a little bit on what you were talking about. Because these tires don't fall off as much, a little pit strategy maybe.
And we saw Eric Almirola missed his pit stall. Had to back up to get fuel back in.
Now he's leaving pit road, headed back towards the racetrack.
What an adventurous trip down pit road this was for the 51
truck. It's not over yet for him either. There's a 15 of Nelson Piquet Jr. He's going to pull out of the pit and actually run into, and that their teammates.
Well, that doesn't make any sense at all. Both of them had plenty of room, and they elected Nelson, not to use it.
Yeah, Nelson Piquet should have seen that there was a truck on his outside.
He might have been looking another way.
Quite possible.
Hey, look at there, the 6 truck. Back on the lead lap. Aaron's lucky dog, Lance Fenton, receives it.
That's a good-looking truck, that Fuel Doctor truck from Rick Ware.
Completed 14 laps of the 146 scheduled for tonight's race. And again, as you mentioned, Lance Fenton back on the lead lap because of the Aaron's lucky dog. Out in front, it's been Austin Dillon since the drop of the green flag. James Buescher was able to get by Johnny Sauter to take second. Todd Bodine's moved up to fourth. And Ron Hornaday running out our top five.
You know, if I'm James Buescher, I got to get me a good restart. You know, I need to be able to get a good restart to get my confidence back. Late in the race up there at New Hampshire, they got around him and won that race. And then on the start of this race, it didn't go well either.
Again, NASCAR making sure that there's no fluids on the racetrack. So while they are making sure that we don't have problems on the track, we're going to slip away and get a quick little break in here. Again, great side-by-side racing already, and we're just 14 laps into it. Stay with us here on Speed. Monday night, Steve Burns breaks down the drama from Dover. And let me tell you, there's been plenty of drama already. And he'll look ahead to the race number 3 in Kansas. Watch NASCAR Race Show presented by Hooters Monday night, 7 Eastern, only on Speed.
Had a great feature on Harry Gant last week on the Race Hub.
Yeah, it was spectacular. I'm guessing we're going to have a feature on Harvick and Hamlin and the little battle that they've gotten in with each other at Dover.
We haven't even run the race yet. That was practice.
Things are getting quite dicey in the chase for the championship, aren't they?
Very interesting.
War of words.
We've only run one race.
Hey, I've got a question. Those guys left the pit, went out on the racetrack and ran into each other and then came in and argued about it.
Yeah, and parked right beside each other.
Okay, why didn't they argue about it first? I mean,
that would have saved a lot of trouble.
That would have certainly saved a lot of time and trouble.
Let's make sure we don't have problems here on the racetrack at Las Vegas. We might have some timbers flaring.
There's a lot going to go down here, too, Rick.
We've got a lot of laps of racing still to go. 130 laps remaining. We're about to get underway with lap number 18. We're on lap 17, and it's Austin Dillon choosing the outside line once again. Green flag back in the air. Another great restart for Dillon.
Yeah, he's able to clear James Buescher before they even get remotely close to turn number 1.
That's what I talked about with James. That's got to get on your mind, nerves mentally, Rick. He's going to have a restart later in this race. I'm sure that could determine whether he wins it or not. This one here, he went from second place to look like he could be fourth or fifth by the time it's towards out.
Yeah, he's right now in a side-by-side battle for the third position. Top 09 able to get by. And now he's going to try to chase down Austin Dillon.
All the way to the bottom of the racetrack goes Todd Bodine, so he secures second behind Austin Dillon. Let's see if he's got anything for the 20-year-old. They go side by side for that third spot. Johnny Sauter takes it away from the 31 of James Buescher.
Man, James is fast through the center of the turn. Once he gets that thing wound up, he's really fast. But those spots he loses on those restarts can be costly.
Skinner, Hornaday, Mousen, Lofton, Eichler, and Jason Bowles are your top 10.
That's my spotlight guy. He drove from 20th to 10th already. Talking to those guys down there in the garage area field, they liked what they were seeing out of Jason. He's leaning on his teammate, Ty Bodine, learning quickly. Obviously, it takes a lot to win a K&N championship like he did last year in the West Series. And so this kid's got some talent. It's good to see him get a chance to get out here and show the world.
He had a great battle last year with Eric Holmes, and Eric Holmes is set to win that championship again with 2 races to go. We have all those races right here on Speed.
Skinner and Sauter battling it out, and here comes Hornaday in the 33. He's going to mix it up with these two.
Here's Sauter, very little time out of the throttle. But meanwhile, Skinner's going to pull up beside him.
Yeah, how would you like to run through that corner with your foot on the floor like it sounded like Sauter did, and you look over and there's a guy driving up beside you?
How'd he do that?
About 2 feet away from the guy in front of you. Now to the bottom of the racetrack goes Sauter. Here comes Ron Hornaday on the outside, trying to take that position away. Down the back stretch they go.
Strong move by Hornaday up on the outside. He snuck in there and grabbed that spot away from Johnny Sauter. Great move.
I think Skinner's going to try to follow him along their outside. Remember how good Johnny Sauter was here last year. Side by side now for second. James Buescher is recovered from that restart and now battling for second.
Looks like Buescher has a problem getting up to speed early in a run, but the truck really comes to him a little bit later, a couple laps into it. Now he's trying to take second away from Todd Bodine.
He's got that spot. That just shows you how strong that truck is. We know how difficult it is to complete passes down on the bottom.
Problem on the racetrack. The 47 of Jeffrey Earnhardt gets turned around.
Lorraine Karthikeyan also gets turned around. Great job by Rick Crawford avoiding that situation.
Look at all that mess. They're still trying to dodge each other over there.
And Jeffrey Earnhardt came down from the wall, and a lot of trucks still dodging to make sure they didn't make contact, but he's got a left front tire down on that 47.
Yeah, they're all four flat spotted too. They're going to be a mess. We saw all the smoke from him as he is spinning around. So he'll have to have four tires, but it doesn't look like anybody got any damage out of all that mess.
Yeah, that's incredible, too. Some nice driving jobs by some of those guys to avoid them. Remember, you're coming off that corner probably at 145 or 50 miles an hour, and all of a sudden somebody's sideways in front of you.
So the second caution coming out early on, this one on lap 23. Austin Dillon still out in front. James Buescher had moved back up into second. Todd Bodine third. Hornaday and Skinner rounding out our top five.
See, Jeffrey Earn has already spun down off the racetrack. Now he slides back up. It looked like Narain, watch Rick Crawford now, just barely miss the 47 of Jeffrey Earnhardt.
Now watch Earnhardt turn hard left, and that made some trucks that were getting there really late have to make some crazy moves.
Looked like there was a chicane in the backstretch there.
Watch this Earnhardt truck. You could see Narain was just up high trying to miss. Look at Rick Crawford. Now watch this truck of the 47. Holy cow.
Wow. Is that David Starr maybe that just barely missed him?
Very close call for, it looked like David Starr. And now we've got a few trucks making their way onto pit road, right?
And Rick, it'll be interesting to see what strategies everybody employs here. Seems a little bit early for tires. Schrader had already put his tires on, and his teammate Ron Hornaday going to get fuel only in that Easy Go Chevrolet. On the bottom of your screen, they're going to pack it full. They'll hold their tires for later. Adam?
Middle of your screen, James Buescher also will go fuel only. They never really debated about what to do. Meanwhile, top of your screen, the race leader, Austin Dillon, said, let's get four tires. They are not going to make any changes to the chassis. They are very happy with how it's handling. These pit stops coming at lap 23, and it will be James Buescher, the first off pit road.
Austin Dillon will come off pit road in fourth, so he loses three spots, loses that top position. Ken Schrader moving up 11 spots on pit road to third.
Yeah, remember, Kenny put tires on that first caution flag, so we know he needs to save his tires. He just did fuel only for some track position.
So Jeffrey Earnhardt and Narain Karthikeyan having problems getting out of turn number two. That brings out our second caution, and a wild one. Jason White has to avoid going through the smoke coming out of turn number two. We'll be back. More racing here on Speed. Stay with us. Many fortunes won and lost on the strip in Las Vegas, Nevada. At the racetrack, someone trying to figure out if they can make a fortune or maybe make a name for themselves and then make that fortune in racing. Be the biggest racing fan you can be with Verizon Championship Racing at the track and on your phone. From nationwide IndyCar driver meet and greets to exclusive peeks inside the Penske Garage, right on your VCast phone. Your hard card to racing nirvana. Only from the network with the most 3G coverage, Verizon.
We got Norm Benning back on the lead lap, Phil.
Yeah, Norman got Aaron's lucky dog.
Just keeps trucking right along, logging laps.
Top four trucks on the racetrack stayed out that time. Did not pit. They had all pitted on lap number 13. Actually, David Mayhew right now running fourth, pitted on lap number 16.
So we've got Timothy Peters, Ricky Carmichael, Nelson Piquet Jr., and David Mayhew. They are your top four. James Buescher, he is running in the fifth spot.
And this is a tense time for these guys, Phil. They got some guys up front that hadn't been there. They don't know what kind of trucks. We know the speed that Austin Dillon has, obviously, and the guys that were chasing him. Now they've got some wild cards up ahead of them that they've got to be able to tiptoe their way through.
It's Timothy Peters back in the gas. Green flag back out at Las Vegas.
We had a nice mix of guys getting four tires and some guys getting fuel only on this last pit stop.
Side by side for the lead. Here comes Ricky Carmichael. He's going to take the top spot away from Timothy Peters. Three wide behind him.
Ricky Carmichael trying to lead his first lap of 2010.
Wow, how many wide that? Three or four?
These guys for the seventh spot.
Well, what a wide of trucks we have there.
Ricky Carmichael, as you mentioned, Phil, trying to lead that first lap of 2010. He'll cross the stripe in front.
Austin Dillon already made his way up to the fourth position. Remember, he has fresh tires.
Here comes Ron Hornaday looking to the outside of Ricky Carmichael for that lead. Down the backstretch they go. It's Nellis straightaway. Nellis Air Force Base just off the backstretch of Las Vegas Motor Speedway.
Ricky ticked that box of leading the lap, and then Ron said, I hope you enjoyed that. I'm going to be on my way here.
Austin Dillon trying to make his way underneath the third place truck of Timothy Peters. Look at that wide back there. Johnny Sauter jumps to the outside of Jason Bowles.
And then Jared Pomeroy to the bottom. He's inside of Bowles.
Just drops back behind.
Ooh, Nelson Piquet Jr. shoots up the racetrack.
17 of Timothy Peters trying to hold on to that third position as Austin Dillon still back there in fourth. Now Timothy Peters trying to get by Ricky Carmichael. Adam Alexander.
Rick, prior to the green flag tonight, we talked about all the success for rookie Austin Dillon. It's been an amazing first year in the Camping World Truck Series, but he's very coachable. He always wants to get better. And by taking four tires on that first pit stop, it put him back in the pack somewhere he had not been tonight. His crew chief, Danny Stockman, gave him some good advice. He said, this truck is going to be much tighter now that you're in traffic. And his spotter, Andy Houston, said, this is a great time to practice patience. So much for that. Here goes Dillon under Peters for third.
You know what I like most about what I saw last week at Loudon, guys? This kid's been cool all year long, but things have gone well. At Loudon, it didn't go well, but his tone, his demeanor never changed. He just kept reporting to the crew that the truck wasn't right and they needed to figure out how to fix it. And when Saturday rolled around for the race, they did fix it. They improved it a great deal.
Ended up with a top five finish.
That's
there.
Right. And his patience and his persistence was something that I think showed a level of maturity that I didn't know he had, because things had always gone so well for him.
Now we hear the Danny Stockman saying, try to use some of that patience once again. This is early in this race. Again, 146 laps scheduled. We're only on lap 32 now.
I'd like to see Austin try that outside line a little bit here. We've seen some guys make some good ground on the outside. You see Timothy Peters jump to the outside right now. Austin wiggled a little bit through the center of the corner that time.
Another truck jumping to the outside. You can see on the end of the back of our screen there, James Buescher made his way around David Mayhew. David had restarted inside the top five and had stayed there. Was running fifth all the way till they come off turn two there. And we know how fast Buescher's truck is. He was able to get around the outside of David, but good solid start for this guy.
Timothy Peters trying to take second away from Ricky Carmichael. And here comes Austin Dillon looking to the bottom of the racetrack, trying to get by that 17 of Timothy Peters. Now to the inside of the four of Ricky Carmichael for third.
Timothy had a great run off that corner coming off turn number four, able to make that pass on Ricky and clear him. Austin trying to do the same thing right now.
Carmichael trying to come back down to the white line. They go through three and four. This is one of those racetracks where coming out of turn number four, we'll see guys get a little bit loose, maybe have to turn a little bit harder to the left to stay out of that wall. It almost seems like it comes up quick on these guys.
Oh, it's a because of all the speed, Rick, you know the exit of turn four is more sweeping than the one off turn two. So you just leave that gas pedal right on the floorboard through the center of the corner. And if you're a little bit tight, it tightens up drastically when you're coming off that turn late. So these guys, you're right, have to battle those trucks to get them off turn four. You're going to use up every bit of ground you got. That's what a race car driver does. And you know that the exit of turn four is more sweeping, so you're like, I can get a little bit more there than I can off two. Sometimes it'll bite you.
Because of that straight back straightaway, it tightens up a little bit off of turn number two. Here they are right here exiting turn number two. Great battle for third position here with these three drivers.
Ricky Carmichael holding on to it. Austin Dillon trying to take it on the inside, and James Buescher back there in the 31. Again, that's third, fourth, and fifth.
What a great battle. The two behind them have been side by side, lap after lap. 2-0, he's sideways. that's Mike Skinner, who was down on the inside of David Mayhew, and he about lost that truck off four, Phil.
And look at that momentum he lost, too, that just allowed Johnny Sauter just to catch him and drive right by him. When you run so close to wide open around here, you have to get it on the throttle for any reason because of a problem, and you just lose all your momentum. Ray, what's going on with David Mayhew?
Well, Phil, I just think it's interesting how many different pit strategies we've had already in this race tonight. On that first pit stop, Mayhew came in, had a little bit of a rub on the right side, so they went with right side tires only, and he stayed out for track position on the last round at lap 23. Adam?
Ray, just a moment ago, we saw a big wiggle out of Mike Skinner on the racetrack. Perhaps they went too far on their adjustments when they made their pit stop at lap 23. He was complaining the truck was tight. He got four tires on that cycle of pit stops, and they loosened him up. Maybe they went too far. We'll continue to keep our eye on driver number five. He's riding in the top 10.
You know, Phil, this might be a wise time for David just to roll up top and let these two go. They're faster than him. He can see that gap ahead of him. Skinner's almost already spun them both out because of the way they're racing side by side. David just needs to log some laps, learn what he's doing. And right now, all he's doing is getting on Johnny Sauter and Mike Skinner's nerves.
That's a great truck, too. That's the truck that Ron Hornaday actually crashed in Pocono. Kevin Harvick, KHI, put a brand new body on that truck, and that's it that David Mayhew's driving. Now he's able to squirt ahead of these two, and he leaves Sauter and Skinner to be side by side.
Yeah, it's a little early in the race. I'm all for racing and racing hard, but we saw Skinner.
And almost around goes the five of Skinner. Sauter doesn't back off. He stays in the back bumper of the five. It gets airborne.
That's tore that truck all to pieces, Phil.
Yeah, it just folded that splitter right up underneath that truck. Looked like Johnny Sauter got into him a little bit and then just looked like he never turned him loose.
If he had just backed off the gas, maybe Skinner did an amazing job keeping that thing straight.
Adam?
Well, Mike Skinner just came on the radio after he saved it and said the obvious. We got the splitter. We're going to need some tires. And then he said, what's that about? He just wrecked me. Who was it? They relayed to him from the spotter stand. It was Johnny Sauter, and he couldn't believe it. So now he's going to have to make a pit stop. Takes him out of what could be an opportunity here tonight because that truck was pretty good.
Yeah, and a lot of damage, too. Add him to that front end. I mean, he's got more than a splitter problem there.
That's exactly right. His chances of being competitive are over with.
Yeah,
check this out.
Airborne.
This is what I was talking about, Rick. This is why these guys were probably, Jason was getting on their nerves a little bit. He put these two in this position. Watch Mike get sideways and saves it, but then Johnny just doesn't let him go.
And right here, he goes airborne.
Oh, that looked like Kyle Busch qualifying one day, remember?
Yes. So a lot of damage to the front end of the five. We see it once again. 13 in the five coming off of turn four.
Wow. Oh, look at that.
Yeah, look
He's
at the
lucky.
Damage to that truck, too.
Lucky he didn't bounce back out in the middle of all that traffic. Did a good job of saving that thing to start with.
This is what Tom O'Dine saw with his onboard. He saw him. He just backed off for a minute when Skinner went to the left. Todd got right back in the throttle.
You know, it might be a little unfair to say that Johnny Sauter got into the back. Skinner lost it on his own at first, and it looked like from our angle that maybe Johnny finished him off, but I couldn't really 100% tell.
Well, you know, Mike Skinner, when he's sideways like that, the air is going to be stopping that truck. Johnny could very well have been out of the throttle, just couldn't get stopped enough.
So our third caution has come out. This time it's Mike Skinner, former winner at this racetrack, that's had the problems. He'll have to come to pit road and fix the front end. Experience an all-new speed.com and find the latest video highlights, in-depth stats, expert analysis, driver blogs, photo galleries, and feature stories. Get more at speed.com's NASCAR section.
James Busch is going to have another opportunity on the restart to be up in the front row. All of them good experience. He needs to figure out how to get that thing going.
He's a little bit quicker.
Going to get many chances tonight the way these guys are sliding around. We've seen a lot of action early in the going.
We had a few guys make their way onto pit road moments ago. Let's go to Ray Dunlap, get an update.
Well, I'll give you an update on Kenny Schrader's Kroger Chevrolet first. He came in there on lap number 41, and believe it or not, they've put another four tires on. They think they may have had a loose wheel on the right rear. For Ricky Carmichael, he came in and also trouble on the pit stop. He'll have a penalty. You'll have to go to the tail end for not controlling a tire during the pit stop. Adam?
Timothy Peters came down at lap 40. He got tires for the first time tonight, his only other pit stop coming at lap 13. He has been loose. They made an adjustment. And should we get a long green flag run here, keep your eye on Peters. Here's the reason why. They had trouble fueling the truck. They're not sure that they got it full of fuel. So that could be an issue should we get a long green flag run right here.
You can lose these things on pit road just as easily as you can lose them on the racetrack.
So again, Hornaday now out front of this field. James Buescher running in the second spot. Hornaday, one of the best of all time as far as restarts go. So James Buescher probably will look like he's going to fall back, even though he might have the best restart of his life.
You know, Ron Hornaday is one of the best all time and more than just restarts.
Yeah, he has a few wins actually in this series as well and leads
several championships.
It's just four.
Yeah. Do you know he's won on 29 different tracks in the NASCAR Camping World Truck Series?
Has That's he incredible. Won here, Michael?
But not on this one. He's close. He's second. In fact, in 9 starts here, he has 7 top 10 finishes, but he's never been able to pull off a win.
Yeah, 5 top fives in those 9 starts. But he did finish second back in 98. But again, that was the old configuration.
That's right.
Yellow lights came back out on the pace truck.
Now, I think
they're going to make him go around again.
I like to think that's just a coincidence. You know, he hadn't had things right at this particular track. Obviously, Ron knows how to win on 29 different tracks. He could very easily add number 30 to it right here tonight.
Well, guys, it's time to take a closer look into the camping experience with Camping World's Destination Recreation.
It's Camping World's Destination Recreation.
You know, over the last couple of months on Destination Recreation, we've been coming to Camping World to take a look at their huge inventory. Now, they've got things like travel trailers, toy haulers, and Class C gas-powered motorhomes. But today, I want to talk about the Mac Daddy units, the Class A. You know, many of these have all the bells and whistles that you're looking for, but what I really like is most of them are powered by a diesel engine, and it's highly fuel efficient. On Camping World's lots today, they've got Monaco, Damon, and American Coach, just to name a few. So if you want a Mac Daddy ride and a Class A motorhome, this is the Class A way to get it done.
The Camping World Destination Recreation Sweepstakes is back, and it's obviously better than ever. More prizes, more chances to win. To enter and to see the complete prize descriptions and official rules, all you have to do is visit www.campingworld.com/racing. Michael?
I bet you could take a nice nappy poo in there.
Ray, I did. I believe he did that last week. Stay with us. Green flag will fly next. Coverage of the NASCAR Camping World Truck Series on Speed is brought to you by Dodge. Visit Dodge.com or your local dealer today. By Royal Purple, the performance oil that outperforms. And by Chamberlain Garage Door Openers, your welcome home. Lights are back off of the pace truck, meaning that they will come back out of turn four and we'll see the green flag. And they'll restart. Hornaday will be on the outside. Now we've seen a pattern start. The guy who is number one gets to choose if he wants the outside or inside. And so far on the start and every restart, we have had the leader choose the outside line. So Hornaday brings the field back to the green flag. It goes in the air. He goes, and Buescher tries to stay with him.
Like Eric Almirola maybe jumped out of line a little bit soon there, Phil. Going wide. We saw the problems he was having on pit road. Like he tried to grab some of those spots back and got a great start. I just hope he didn't pass before the start finish line. Looked like he might have.
Yeah, NASCAR officials will monitor that. And somebody against the outside wall coming off turn two. James Buescher now all the way back to the fourth position, but drives hard into the corner to get by the 88 of Matt Crafton.
Johnny Sauter has second, James Buescher third, Crafton is fourth. A battle for the fifth spot. Austin Dillon on the inside, Ryan Eichler on the outside.
Man, I like what Buescher's able to do with that truck down on the bottom, Phil. We don't see many people be able to make moves like that around the bottom of the racetrack and just power down into the corner and make it stick. He's done it repeatedly.
And now he's jumped to the outside and driven around the 13 of Johnny Sauter to take over the second position.
James Buescher looking strong once again this week. He was so close to his first win in the Camping World Truck Series a week ago at Loudon. A late caution had him battle with Kyle Busch on the restart. Kyle Busch was able to get by him and take that win. And now Hornaday out in front of him here in Vegas.
You've seen a couple of guys pound off the wall and go still make their way to victory lane. Kyle Busch certainly made it fun last week. There's Buescher back to the bottom.
battle for the lead. Here comes James Buescher. He's got the preferred line now through three and four. Let's see if Hornaday can keep the momentum up on the outside.
Yeah, James Buescher's truck is so strong. He's not quite going to be able to clear Hornaday. They're going to be side by side at the start finish line. Hornaday with the edge.
They continue to battle side by side. Buescher on the bottom of the track. Hornaday on the outside.
How about teammates just about getting ready to be side by side behind them? Sauter and Crafton.
We saw some side by side racing earlier, and it didn't bode well for Mike Skinner, who ended up in the grass and airborne, and a lot of damage to the front end of his truck. Now, side by side is Buescher and Hornaday for the lead. Hornaday has the edge when they cross the stripe.
All we do in the truck series is race side by side for the lead. That's what happened all week last week in Loudon, and here it is going on again here at Las Vegas. But this is more difficult, Phil. This is really a tough job for James Buescher to hang down on the inside of Hornaday like that, and he's making it look easy. That truck looks very stable down on the bottom, but it's tough, believe me.
And that shows how good that truck is. He's consistently driven to the front from the drop of the green flag.
This looks exactly like last week. Kevin Harvick was just all but by Kyle Busch 100 times, but never could complete the pass. So they just come across the start-finish line side by side, and these two do it again.
Last lap, they cross the stripe at 25 one-thousandths that separated the two. This last time by 34 one-thousandths separated the two.
Bigger lead for Hornaday.
Just behind him is Sauter and Crafton, teammates going third and fourth. Then Austin Dillon back in the fifth spot.
Buescher was able to complete that pass off turn two, slide up in front of Hornaday. And you thought that Austin Dillon looked strong in the early part of the race with that lead? I believe old James Buescher is getting ready to show you some strength here.
He's been able to pass more trucks than Austin Dillon has. When Austin got hung in behind after some pit stops, he hasn't been able to march forward like James Buescher has been.
We've seen guys a lot of times when they just get so close to grabbing that victory and it slips away from them, they can rebound in a hurry because they tasted it. They could feel what it was going to be like to be standing in victory lane, and they don't want to be denied. And I think James is just like that tonight.
Yeah, had it not been for a late green-white checker, I think James Buescher would have probably been in victory lane at Loudon last week.
Yeah, he had a 3-truck length lead over Kyle Busch before the caution came out, and then obviously on the restart had to battle side by side with him and didn't end up on the winning end of that one. But right now looking very strong out front, looking for his first win. Three drivers have scored their first career win at Las Vegas Motor Speedway. David Starr back in 2002, Shane Meal in 2004, and Johnny Sauter a year ago.
And that win that Shane Meal had was the first win ever for Billy Blue, as we see Austin Dillon move up beside him, Matt Crafton, in a battle for fourth.
Like he might have the advantage on Crafton, but see if he can do like James does and really stick down. See, he can't do that.
Whoa, look at that truck go.
Way up the racetrack for Austin Dillon.
That's what James's truck looks so good doing. It'll stick on the bottom when he sticks it, when he dives down in the corner. These other guys can't hold it there.
No, Austin's going to try that high line. We've seen some trucks make some good time up there. Let's take a look at what happened that last corner. He got down on the bottom. It's really rough down there, Michael. There's sets of bumps. And Todd Bodine was telling me that the truck will get to bouncing in those bumps, and you just keep losing ground, losing the front end as you hit those bumps. And that looks like that's what happened to Austin.
Matt Crafton is pretty lucky that he was ahead of him when all that happened, because that truck just turned, went straight up the hill where Crafton was riding along at.
How about Taylor Balsam back in the truck series in the number 25 Exide Toyota?
Coming back in as a teammate to Mike Skinner. That's the second truck out of the Randy Moss Motorsports.
Battle for third. Austin Dillon all over the back bumper of Johnny Sauter. You know, earlier, Ray had mentioned that he thinks that maybe a three would be in victory lane tonight, at least a three on the door panel. So he included the 33, the 3, the 13, the 30. He's got a lot of options.
How about the guy leading the 31?
And the 31.
The first four trucks right now all have threes in their numbers.
Pretty good bet.
Where did he get that down at? I want to get some of that action.
I don't think anyone took it. James Buescher out front now. He has a 1-second lead over Ron Hornaday. Johnny Sauter, Austin Dillon, and Matt Crafton are your top five. Eichler, Almirola, Malsom, Bodine, Karthikeyan, your top 10. Right now, after James Buescher was able to clear the 33 of Ron Hornaday, he has been able to check out. So James Buescher and Hornaday 1 and 2. Buescher
extending his lead over the field. But that doesn't mean there's not side-by-side racing behind him, and we have seen some bumping and banging early on here at Vegas. Caution just coming out on the Smith's Food and Drug Stores 350 from Las Vegas Motor Speedway. The six getting sideways and turned around coming out of four, that's Lance Fenton. And also spinning about the same time was the 73 of Rick Crawford. But he was on the opposite side of the racetrack when the caution came out. And here come the trucks onto pit road, right?
Lap number 60 here, and Ron Hornaday will come for sure. They want to pull a rubber out of the left rear for his truck, and he said, we got to do something with tire pressure. I am not able to get off the corner. You see Hornaday in the center of your screen, and he just said that whoever was up front passed the pace car. Hornaday going to get four tires here. Adam?
Top of your screen, James Buescher, the race leader, comes in. He's not taking tires until now. Lap 61, when he's going to get tires for the first time tonight. He said he was good center off. Meanwhile, bottom of your screen, Johnny Sauter, the winner of this race a year ago, said, I don't know what to tell you. I'm loose in traffic. They will make an adjustment and perhaps a slow stop for him. The Jackman slipped. These pit stops coming at lap 61.
A lot of strategy on pit road now. Almirola moves up six spots. Peters up nine. Jason White up 10 positions. Matt Crafton holds on to that fifth spot coming off of pit road. We'll re-rack them and get ready for the green flag. Stay with us. Friday, four-time Sprint Cup champion Jimmy Johnson stops by the biggest party in racing. Don't miss NASCAR Trackside from Kansas Friday, 7 Eastern, only on Speed.
Jimmy has a little work to do in that chase. Didn't have a great finish last week. First time, first race out in the chase. You know he's going to be there, I would think.
Yeah.
Aaron's lucky dog.
You know, in 06, I think he came back from 170-some points down.
Yeah, he's like 39th place finish or something.
After seven races. So he and Chad will pull it together and make it fun.
Jimmy Johnson not getting the lucky dog here. Aaron or Norm Benning will be getting it.
I believe that's Normie's second.
It is Norm second. He just goes back to the well, and it pays off for him.
Continues to collect the lucky dogs. How about David Mayhew making his first ever Camping World Truck Series start, and he leads the field.
Why not lead the race?
What, you think that makes Ricky Carmichael mad? He's been racing for a year, and he finally leads one lap. Tonight, David Mayhew shows up and says, look where I'm at, Ricky.
Top two trucks stayed on the racetrack that time. David Mayhew, Ryan Sieg. You see Ryan, the black truck on the inside front row.
What a great qualifying run for Ryan Sieg. He qualified well, and the truck's running good. Check out the moon, man.
It's beautiful.
Full moon over Vegas. What a beautiful day and night. And what a crowd we got. These folks have showed up to check these trucks out.
Gorgeous evening for racing. We're glad you're along with us here on Speed. Coming out of turn four, David Mayhew brings the field through the quad oval, and the green flag will go back in the air. Mayhew and Sieg, one and two.
Timothy Peters got a good start. Looks like he's going to try to take it three wide, Phil.
Looking at the outside of David Mayhew going into turn number one. They're three wide.
He's going up there. Mayhew got a little bit loose.
Yep, he backs off. Almirola on the bottom of the racetrack now moves up to the second spot. So it's Ryan Sieg out in front. Almirola running second.
I don't think David liked any part of that restart.
And he's still in the middle.
Oh, he's in a worse shape now, man. Three wide in the middle.
Sideways. David Mayhew hanging on to it up close to the wall. A couple trucks throwing some dust up as they went by. They stay two and three wide as they cross the stripe.
How about Jason White emerges up in the top five? Remember, he had to go back to the back of the pack for the start of the race because of an engine failure in practice.
That was about as bad of a lap that David Mayhew could have had.
Battle for the lead. Here comes Almirola. And Austin Dillon throwing that number three truck in there for second now. Almirola takes the lead. Dillon down to second.
But Shane Sieg's
three wide behind him for about sixth.
That's for the sixth spot. Hornaday has got it. Jason White and Matt Crafton dropping back to seventh and eighth. Here comes Brian Eichler in the 18.
Look at Ryan Sieg hanging in up there on the high side. Austin Dillon makes the pass and try to shoot up the hill again, but he had cleared Ryan Sieg and got that spot away from him.
It looked exactly like it did against the 88 of Matt Crafton. Here we go three wide again. Johnny Sauter on the very bottom. Now they've settled down to two wide.
man, that's intense after these restarts. These guys are all over one another.
Top of line in the 30 in that Valvoline Toyota Tundra.
Remember our championship point leader by a large margin, but in heavy traffic right now.
Right along with Johnny Sauter. We look back, a great run through the turn for Sauter.
Jason White lost a spot or two in that corner. Johnny Sauter now jumps to the inside of his teammate, Matt Crafton.
And he wobbles down at the bottom of the racetrack, having to check up a bit on that momentum that he had on his teammate. Let's see if he can make the pass at the stripe.
With that momentum from the outside carries Matt Crafton back around him.
Plus, he's got some drafting help there from behind. Brian Eichler back up on the tailgate of Matt Crafton, gave him a push down into that corner. Maybe Crafton can clear him off turn two. I don't know. Sauter's strong down on the bottom.
Those two stay side by side. That's seventh and eighth. Crafton and Sauter. Just behind him, Brian Eichler, Todd Bodine, rounding out our top 10.
Remember now, the 13 and the 8, our teammates out of Thor Sport Racing.
And they're racing door to door across the stripe this time. Sauter had the advantage.
I said teammates now, remember.
I don't know if they heard you. Again, we haven't even reached the halfway point of this one, and these two are battling for seventh like it's the last few laps of the race. Here comes Austin Dillon. He led early in this race, and now he's taken the spot again from Eric Almirola.
Remember, Danny Stockman, his crew chief, kept preaching to him, patience, have patience. He fought his way through about fourth or fifth, ran there in those positions for a long, long time. After this most recent restart, though, he's got the lead back.
Austin Dillon takes the lead away from the 51 of Eric Almirola.
Right. Earlier in practice today, I think this was maybe the worst day for the 51 team. Eric Almirola said this truck was absolutely junk. His crew chief, Richie Waters, says, if you want, we'll load it up on the trailer and go home. They continued to work on it, and on this last pit stop, they went with fuel only. Eric says the truck likes that much, much more than it does when they put on four tires. Adam?
Remember this race 1 year ago? It was the 88 and the 13 finishing 1-2. We're talking about Thor Sport teammates Johnny Sauter and, of course, Matt Crafton. Well, they're running together on track again here this evening. And I talked to both of their crew chiefs prior to the race, each saying the setups for these two trucks virtually identical. They just hope for a similar result to a year ago.
You know, another truck that looks like it doesn't like the tires that's on it now, but as well as he did earlier, is that 31 truck of James Buescher. He's running fourth, but he's been down on the inside of Timothy Peters three or four laps in a row, Phil, and he just can't seem to get his way around Peters. We watched him drive to the lead by sticking dead on the bottom of the track. I'm noticing now that in the center of the corner, he's wandering up off the bottom, and he can't complete this move. Been in this spot for three or four laps now.
It looked like he had the best truck that was able to stay on that bottom right where he is, but he doesn't seem to be making much ground up right now. Oh, Ryan Sieg, off the pace. He was running in the third position. He stayed out on this most recent caution, but serious problems now for Ryan Sieg.
Yeah, Ryan Sieg had just run his fastest lap of the race on lap 68, and now he has slowed way down on the racetrack. He's down on the apron, out of the racing groove, so we stay green.
See, James Buescher is able to finally get around Timothy Peters. What a great run it was for Ryan, too, Phil. He just got that thing up there in the third spot and was able to hang on and was running very fast lap times, like you said, Rick.
Out in front, Austin Dillon. There's Ryan Sieg. Now slow on the racetrack. What are they saying, Ray?
Well, they think the throttle linkage is broken. He said the motor's still running, but when he puts the pedal down, there's absolutely no response. So they'll go underneath the hood and see if they can make a repair there. But it is not a broken engine, just not able to get the power from the foot to the floor.
And yeah. I think that'll mean that he'll be able to make it back around to pit road, because at least it's running under idle in gear.
And he's slowed to an idle pace now as he makes his way through three and four on the apron of the racetrack. But again, we stay green. Austin Dillon out in front of Eric Almirola by 2.5 seconds. So Austin Dillon, once he gets out in the clean air, he's able to check out on the field. Almirola, Buescher, Peters, and Hornaday, your top five. Tomorrow, NASCAR Race Day drives into Dover. Clint Bowyer, Tony Stewart, Kurt Busch, Jeff Burton, and Ryan Newman will join us. Plus, we'll explain why the championship contenders are more worried than usual about the Monster Mile. NASCAR Race Day, built by the Home Depot, live from Dover tomorrow, 10 Eastern, only on Speed.
Austin Dillon continues to check out on the field here in Sin City. He's got a 4-second lead over second place James Buescher. Can Austin Dillon make it back to victory lane? Stay with us. Welcome back to the Smith's Food and Drug Stores 350 as we reach the top of the hour. A guy at the top of his game is the three of Austin Dillon. He's got a 5.5-second lead here at Las Vegas Motor Speedway. Thanks for joining us, Rick Allen, Phil Parsons, Michael Waltrip up here in the booth, Ray Dunlap, Adam Alexander down on pit road, giving you all the stories. Right now, the biggest story is Austin Dillon's dominant performance over James Buescher.
Yeah, we saw James Buescher get the lead, and we thought he was going to be unstoppable. Now Austin has it, and we'll go with him being unstoppable. He's running lap times right now that are comparable to Dillon and also to Amarillo. Both those guys are close to Austin, but he was able to grab that big lead while those others were battling for second, and he's maintained that lead.
Austin's getting ready to lap some pretty good trucks. That's Nelson Piquet Jr. just going down a lap. He's made four previous starts this year, three of those ending up with a top 10 finish.
It's been very impressive how Nelson's adapted to these trucks, grabbing those top 10 finishes.
Ray Dunlap, what's going on with our four-time series champion?
Well, Ron Hornaday's just a little bit tight. They've worked on it on each and every pit stop and made some air pressure adjustments, but I did want to add, throughout the course of the year, they've had quite a few crew changes on this truck. Of course, having a different crew chief this season. And tonight, he is without his regular spotter. Rick Corelli, each and every week, calls the shots for Ron Hornaday from high atop the speedway. But this weekend, he had to go to Dover for some meetings, so he is not here. Doug Sigmund is filling in for him, and Hornaday has been continuing to work with Doug to tell him exactly what he wants to know and how much information he can deliver to him to help him make that truck better tonight. Hornaday continues to run in the top 10, and also the 17 is in the top 10 also, Adam.
Yeah, he's running in the top 10, but not for long, Ray. The reason is he's going to have to come to pit road for an unscheduled pit stop. Overheating. The water temperature was at 280. Water was coming out the overflow, so they decided to make a pit stop. He got damage on his right front. They believe that happened when he was going through some lap vehicles. You can see him beating down that right front of Timothy Peters' machine, a driver that entered top five in points, but is going to take a serious hit here tonight. He continues to sit on pit road. No doubt he's going to lose at least one lap, probably more.
Going to need to get some water in that thing, Phil, or he won't make it to the finish, let alone losing a lap or two.
Yeah, that water is spewing out of that truck. I noticed it while we were away at commercial break, and I didn't quite understand where that damage had come from, but Adam explained it, that he more than likely got together with a lap truck.
Timothy Peters came in the fourth position in the points. He's already dropped one spot down to the fifth spot, and that means Austin Dillon has moved up a couple into the fourth position in our point standings.
He's just made a steady progress up the points ladder since Daytona, had a crash in the first or second lap down there early in the going and resulted in a bad finish. But ever since then, he's been on a roll.
Here's Eric Almirola. The last seven races, Eric Almirola has averaged a fifth place finish.
That's pretty good, right?
And you would think, man, surely he gained some ground on Tabodano point leader. Well, Todd averaged 4.5 over those seven races. And would you believe, because of three of those races, Todd won and all the bonus points, the last seven races with Eric Almirola averaging a fifth place finish, he lost 108 points to Todd.
Unbelievable. What a run Todd Bodine is having.
That's why you thought he was going to win that championship, huh? You get to racing a guy with a 5.0 place finish average, and you put 100 points on him over seven races? And how are you going to lose?
You mentioned his average finish of fifth. Well, he just took fifth away from Ron Hornaday. So now Todd Bodine back into the top five. Adam?
And Almirola with a bit of a chance to gain some points on Bodine here tonight. As you guys pointed out, the 51 currently riding in the third position. And Rick, as you just said, Bodine moved into fifth that last time around. Bodine, though, has had to wrestle this truck all night long. In fact, he did in practice today as well. Tight has been the main word on their radio throughout the evening. They've made a number of adjustments, but I would guess a top five finish on a night when you've had a subpar vehicle, pretty good for the point leader at this stage of the season.
And the 17 of Timothy Peters, they've done a lot of work to that truck already, but they have to go behind the wall to continue the work.
I would guess they couldn't get that hood up out on pit road, Phil, and they have to get some water in that truck or it'll blow the engine up. So they went behind pit road. The caution's out.
Caution comes out for the fifth time tonight. The last time it came out, it was the sixth of Lance Fenton having problems, as well as the 73 of Rick Crawford. Now, the fifth time the caution has come out.
Guys, we're showing 51 laps to go right now. By the time the field gets gathered up behind the pace truck and they get ready to come down pit road, it'll be 49 or 50 laps to go. That means we will get in our window to be able to finish this thing from this point.
And these guys will all pit here, Phil, and they'll get their tires and they'll be done. We've seen these tires hold up. They've got really good speed all the way through a fuel run. So I think this will take any strategy out of winning this race. I think now it'll just be a matter of speed, because they'll all do basically the same thing now. Don't you believe?
I absolutely think so. And maybe who wins that race off pit road? We saw Austin Dillon, when he got back and forth to fifth, have a little bit of a problem trying to make his way back to the front.
This time the caution is for debris, and that benefits the 12 of Mario Gosselin. He'll receive the Aaron's Lucky Dog.
The Tire Monkey is going back on the lead lap.
Remember, he's got that other sponsor here for a few races this year. Tire Monkey's going to be back. Excel Construction Company on board Mario's truck this week.
That will put 17 trucks on the lead lap when Mario Gosselin is able to pass the pace truck and make it all the way around. And again, as you mentioned, maybe the race off of pit road will determine who wins this race. We've seen some incredible strength out of the three of Austin Dillon and the 31 of James Buescher when they're in front.
Yeah, and these two are 1-2 right now. They come off pit road that way, and then it'll just be a battle of the two fastest trucks right at the front. That's what we saw last week at Loudon all day long. But then at the end, there was a twist in the plot. And James entered the picture and was almost going to drive off with the victory. So you never know what's going to happen in these darn truck races.
And Michael, wouldn't you think, because we have a full run to go, that I think everyone's going to put four on? I don't really see anybody putting two tires on right here.
No, I think everything will be the same. Four tires for everybody, and they'll be done pitting. But we'll see.
Here comes Austin Dillon. Again, right behind him, the 31 of James Buescher, Eric Almirola, Johnny Sauter, Todd Bodine. They're your top five, all on pit road.
Yeah, no mistakes on pit road. No speeding, no tires getting away. This is the big one right here, Ray.
And Phil, they had gone 36 laps, so you were right. They are going to need enough fuel here where you definitely would go four tires. For Eric Almirola, they're going to go down 1 pound out of the right side tires. They got to make sure they pack that second can in. Adam?
Middle of your screen, James Buescher said he was much tighter on that run. They're going to make an adjustment with air pressure and try and free him up. Top of your screen, Austin Dillon, the race leader, said his truck got tighter as the run continued. They didn't talk about any adjustments. Four tires and fuel for Dillon. He stalls the engine, but he will easily be the first off pit road, and that is huge because we all know how good he has been out front tonight.
He probably stalled the engine because it scared him they were done so fast.
And I'm sure that Dillon will choose the outside line once again. That's where he has restarted and started this race at the beginning after winning his fifth pole in his career. Can he win it from the pole? You got to stay with us to find out. Gorgeous area, Las Vegas, Nevada. We get an overhead look at some of the beautiful buildings, facilities here. And one of those, the Las Vegas Motor Speedway, the Smith's Food and Drug Stores 350. Again, 146 laps scheduled for this one, just over 200 miles.
We need to see what James does here, you know, Phil?
Yeah.
If he can just survive this
without
restart,
going back to third or fourth.
Yeah, second's okay. He's good enough, depending on how his tires match up. You know, if this truck's as good as it was earlier, he's good enough to race Austin head-to-head. But if he slips back four or five spots and Austin gets that big lead again, he won't ever catch him.
And remember, we got a report that his truck was a little bit tighter that last run. And you mentioned that when we were watching him, he wasn't able to drive by those guys that he had before.
Ray, what are we hearing about 51 of Almirola?
Well, they missed a lug nut down here, which they had to grab and pick up to put on. Eric came in third, went out fifth, and, of course, not very happy about it. And the comment he made is, guess where the 30 is? He's ahead of us, and that's how you win championships.
You know, I quit worrying about that championship, Fizo, Eric. I think that ship has sailed.
Maybe get another win?
Let's try just win a couple races.
Yeah, Eric's been into victory lane, so maybe a third win. Could it come here at Las Vegas? Well, he's got some strong trucks he needs to get by. Up in front, Austin Dillon, James Buescher, 1 and 2. Green flag back in the air.
James did it. He drove off side by side with Austin Dillon. In fact, he sticks that nose out in front as they head toward turn one.
By far the best job he's done on the restart. He has a bit of an edge. Austin has it wound up on the outside more than likely on these new tires. These guys are wide open through that corner.
Here comes Todd Bodine, also throwing his truck into the mix. He's battling side by side with Dillon for second.
What a great job by
James Buescher. He stood up to the challenge, didn't he?
He sure did.
And it's Austin Dillon who's falling back. Todd Bodine takes that spot away. Now Amarola's down on the inside of him.
Austin Dillon looking so strong most of this race. Now will have to battle his way back up. He's running in the third spot.
Look at that move. Goes way up to the racetrack.
That didn't work out the way Ron thought it would. Look at the dirt he's blowing up. That thing just pushed on him when he got down in the center of the corner. And look at all the trucks go by him, Phil.
When he went through those bumps we were talking about earlier, he lost the front end in about 10 spots in the process.
Out in front, James Buescher, Todd Bodine second, Austin Dillon is third. Got a side-by-side battle here. Eric Almirola on the inside and Ryan Eichler on the outside.
We saw Almirola up beside Austin Dillon. He's lost a little bit of ground there. Bounces up the track in front of Eichler, clears him, and that'll allow him to try to return. Nope, it won't either. Eichler says, I like that spot. You couldn't do it, but I think I can.
These guys, neither one of them want to lose touch with those front three trucks right now. And this running side-by-side is allowing those three trucks to get away.
Almost contact there. Eric Almirola not wanting to give up the ground that he had gained. And so Almirola goes by the 18 of Eichler, as does the 4 of Ricky Carmichael. Now Carmichael on the outside of that 18 trying to stay there.
There goes Austin Dillon. He gets to the inside of Todd Bodine in a battle for second.
Going to the bottom of the racetrack. He takes second away from Todd Bodine. Now he'll try to reel back in that 31.
Look at the difference between 3 and 4 and 1 and 2. We saw Austin go down there, stayed right on the bottom, put as you please, but it's a lot rougher down in 1 and 2. We've seen him lose his front end a couple times when he tried to do it down at that end of the racetrack.
More racing as they go into 1 and 2.
Johnny Sauter down on the inside, right tucked in beside.
Taylor Mawson, good run for Taylor Mawson in his return to the truck series.
Driving at 25, he's in the ninth position. Johnny Sauter down on the bottom of the racetrack. Here we go for battle for the lead. James Buescher out in front. Austin Dillon throwing the nose down the inside of Buescher, trying to take that spot away as they go to turn one.
Let's see if that truck sticks now on the bottom, if he doesn't lose that front end.
It's sticking, Phil. I think he's going to make the pass.
Completes the pass. Austin Dillon back to the front.
How old are those two?
Well, Austin 20. Dillon, he's just 20, and James Buescher, he's just 20.
40 combined.
Ooh, that hurt. I'm older than that.
Todd Bodine's running third.
Oh, Noreen Karthikeyan into the wall. That will bring out our sixth caution as the flag flies now. Into turn three was where Noreen Karthikeyan got into the wall. Now he makes his way onto pit road, but not before the pace is slowed once again with just 40 laps of racing to go.
Yeah, Noreen had got into the wall earlier, so more than likely he probably had a tire rub and probably lost that right front tire. As you can see, it's down right now. Let's take a look at the first incident between Noreen and the outside wall. You see him racing with David Mayhew.
Well, he slides up in front of David, in fact, all the way up to the wall. And you're right, Phil. The reason why he wrecked the second time was that right there. Put that right front fender down on that tire, and it just blew out.
Yeah, he rode around for another half, three-quarters of a lap, and then the other end of the racetrack are actually going in turn number three. Watch this now. You see the tire goes down. Nothing he could do at that point. That was hard enough contact on that first incident, Michael, that I think he probably should have been directed to pit road.
Immediately. We saw smoke, and it just anytime you hit it that hard, man, you're not going to be able to survive that. Now they've got bigger problems. It's going to take a baseball bat to get the tire off.
Noreen's had some great finishes this year. 13th at Martinsville and 11th at Texas. 14th his most recent run when we were in Chicago.
This one hadn't gone so smooth for him. Spun out earlier in the race off turn two over there, and now hit the wall twice, and the second one was the might have been the knockout punch.
Be fortunate if it didn't bust a brake rotor when he hit that wall.
Well, bad news for Noreen Karthikeyan. Austin Dillon's out front. Welcome back to Las Vegas Motor Speedway in Las Vegas, Nevada. Who's going to cash in tonight? James Buescher on the inside, Austin Dillon on the outside. Our Aaron's lucky dog goes to Jeffrey Earnhardt. He's in. Adding some fuel, making a few adjustments to that race truck. Let's go trackside to Adam Alexander.
Rick, there's nothing like the confidence of a rookie. Austin Dillon, the leader on the last restart, lost the lead, dropped back to third. That because James Buescher laid back and made a nice jump. So under the caution. They discussed that last restart. Austin Dillon said, don't worry about it. It won't happen again. We're about to find out if it will or not, Ray.
Well, the 33 truck was up in the top five most of the evening, but you see him nowhere near there now. That's because they just pitted again. He was very, very tight. They had pulled some spring rubbers out, and for some reason, Hornaday's nose was dragging on the track really badly and not good through the bumps. They came in and made some big time adjustments on that Easy Go Chevrolet.
So he'll be mired back in the field a bit. There are 18 trucks on the lead lap. Hornaday will, looks like, restart in the 17th spot. Again, Earnhardt got the Aaron's lucky dog. We have a few trucks that are a lap down.
This is fun. We heard the talk about Austin Dillon not liking exactly the way James played the restart game last time. He's going to do something about it. Let's see what he does.
We're going to see it again. Green flag back in the air. Austin Dillon with a great restart this time. James Buescher to his inside.
I think Austin said when he got near that line, I'm going to go. He lays back on me, I'm going to leave him laying back there.
But here comes James Buescher, strong on the inside. He tries to take the lead again as they go through one and two.
Slides up the racetrack right in front of Austin Dillon. It opens up the bottom for Ty Bodine, and here comes Sauter.
Three wide now, the battle for second. Johnny Sauter on the bottom of the racetrack. He wants to get to victory lane again, defend his win from a year ago.
Okay, James Buescher certainly has learned from his earlier restarts.
He's fixed now. He's a restart guy.
Top of nine, Eric Almirola, one and two in the points, racing side by side for the fourth spot.
Only problem is he's run up against a guy that's got a truck that's handling really well right now. Austin Dillon drives around James Buescher down into turn one.
Todd Bodine moved up the racetrack. Eric Almirola had to give him some space, and when he did that, Ryan Eichler in the 18 moved to the inside of that 30, trying to take the spot away.
See, Eichler trying to keep his nose up underneath that 30 truck, not able to do it. Ricky Carmichael pulls right up behind that 30 truck.
Carmichael, another strong run this season. He's put a couple together, but just hasn't had the finishes to show for it. But maybe tonight will be different.
How about that good battle between the 18 of Eichler and the 19 of Mayhew? These guys have a little history. They raced together in the West Series.
Eichler has the advantage now. He's in front of Lofton and Mayhew.
That was tight right there. Looked like maybe Lofton got in the back of Eichler on the back straightaway.
Hey, let's throw an ARCA champion in the middle of those two West guys.
Another guy who has Canon Pro Series East experience was Ricky Carmichael. He was riding for Kevin Harvick and as well as Ken Schrader.
It was just about his only stock car experience prior to getting in this truck.
That's why this stuff's so hard. You hear all the guys we're talking about that have not only experience in other divisions, but they're champions and winners in those divisions. They all come here to the Truck Series and the action picks up.
Things heat up. 97 degrees when this race started. It's cooled off just a bit, but I think we're still in the 90s. The tempers flared early between Johnny Sauter and Mike Skinner. Skinner had the bad end of that. Now we've got some good side-by-side racing between Carmichael and Brian Eichler. Right.
Just to remind you guys, don't forget that the tire got away from the Ford team when we pitted the second round on lap 23. That dropped him back in traffic. Ricky had to move to the front. On one of their other pit stops, they were hanging rubbers in the rear, so that took a bit of extra time. So Ricky has had to come back through the field a number of times. I believe the yellow is coming out right now. Ricky saying on the radio, his truck just a little bit loose coming off the corners.
Sure enough, our seventh caution has come out this time for debris.
Don't you know Austin Dillon said, man, why another restart?
Austin Dillon and James Buescher have had some great battles. Right from the drop of the green flag, we'll see how this one goes as far as the restart. 31 laps of racing to go from Las Vegas Motor Speedway. Stay with us here on Speed. Very similar to a roll of the dice, who is going to get the advantage on the restart here in the Camping World Truck Series. A lot of dice being rolled right there on the strip this evening. Out in front, Austin Dillon, James Buescher, one and two.
You know what, I think one thing may be really interesting right now. Austin Dillon's been beaten twice from the outside when he was on the outside. I think he's going to elect to take the inside and try it there, Michael.
Oh, I don't know about that, Bill. I mean, he looks like that's what he's going to do, but I like the outside still. What about our Aaron's lucky dog, Tony Jackson Jr., getting back on the lead lap? And that will give us 19 trucks on the lead lap. Adam, he took the bottom, is that right?
And, Michael, here's how the conversation went on the radio. Danny Stockman, his crew chief, said, Austin, I think we ought to look at taking the inside lane on the restart. Andy Houston, his spotter, said, I'm going to leave it in your hands, Austin, but I think we ought to consider it. And Austin said, okay, let's give it a shot on the inside. Didn't sound like he was completely sold on it, but after the last two restarts, they're going to give it a shot. And let's face it, he's lost the lead on the last two restarts, and within five laps, he's been able to run down Buescher and get back by him.
You know, guys, I think the situation is that these guys will restart this race and run through one and two wide open, Michael, and the inside's the shortest way around.
Yeah, you remember at Iowa, the crew chief, he gets a lot of input, a lot of direction, and he takes it really well. You remember at Iowa, they told him to start on one side or the other, and he said, I don't think that's a good idea. Here he's following instruction, but I think you're exactly right, Phil. They've learned. They just put it on the mat and run it through one and two, and James Buescher is beating through there twice. So you fool me twice thing.
Shame on
me. Yeah, there's something there.
You'll figure it out. How about we take a look at how they're going to do on the restart? Green flag back in the air. Dillon on the inside, Buescher on the outside. Here comes Sauter behind Dillon, battling for the second spot. A great restart for Austin Dillon.
Might have been a pretty good move to restart from the inside. Plus, getting a good restart helps.
Yeah, what a kind of restart was that for James Buescher? Went from on the front row all the way back to battling for that fourth spot now.
And he's going to lose the fourth spot. Now he's battling for fifth and sixth. Todd Bodine's trying to take fifth away from James Buescher. Here he comes, though, on the outside.
That move around the top. What a strong move by Buescher through three and four.
He said, I'm just going to hold this thing wide open when we get down there.
I think it'll stick, he said.
And it did. And now he's battling for the third spot with Eric Almirola. Three wide as they go into turn number one for about the 10th spot.
Hornaday up on the high side. Remember, he made a late pit stop for some adjustments. Now he's battling his way back into the top 10.
Impressive run on the high side for Hornaday. They stay side by side, Almirola and Todd Bodine. Again, those two are top two in points, and they are running door to door around this racetrack and about running out of racetrack coming out of turn number four.
Well, they were running into each other, that's for sure. It looked like Almirola kind of bent to Todd a little bit.
And the wall, I think he almost hit it too. It's a real close call there off turn four for Eichler for sure.
Austin Dillon, Johnny Sauter, James Buescher, Matt Crafton, 1, 2, 3, and 4. Todd Bodine running in the fifth spot, Almirola sixth, and Brian Eichler in seventh. Brian Eichler actually crushed the wall. Take another look. This is coming out of turn number four.
He stuck up right behind Todd Bodine. Watch Eric Almirola. Ooh, just kissed it with the right rear corner, did Brian Eichler.
And you know what's interesting about that? He gained a little bit of momentum. That means he left his foot right on the floorboard, ran into the wall, and said, I got to get on down to that first turn. Never let off. Never look back.
Final 25 laps of racing from Las Vegas.
Phil, these two guys here, Johnny Sauter and James Buescher, have not let Austin Dillon go anywhere. He's just right there off their nose. Looks like Buescher's actually faster than Sauter. If he can get that second spot, I believe he can go do something with that three.
The top three trucks a lap before this, within 7/1000ths of a second.
Johnny Sauter running in the second spot, Adam, but he's got James Buescher moving to the outside.
And Johnny Sauter right behind him as well. It looked like Buescher may have caught a piece of the wall as he came off turn two there. Sauter, though, having a great late race rally, trying to get his second win in a row at Las Vegas. When he came off pit road at lap 97, the crew did not have a good stop. He lost a number of positions, restarted outside the top 10, and here he is second with 23 laps remaining.
Well, the good news, Adam, is he doesn't have to come to pit road anymore. They're going to settle it right here on the racetrack.
Johnny Sauter now has 7/10 of a second between himself and race leader Austin Dillon. Fourth and fifth, Todd Bodine on the inside, Matt Crafton on the outside, working their way through three and four.
Todd missed a mile and a half, you know. Won 12 times on mile and a half racetracks.
How long is this one?
It's about a mile and a half, I think, the last time they measured.
He knows how to get it done here. He's trying to work that bottom of Matt Crafton and pick up that spot.
Watch him through the bumps right here.
And Phil, what did you say Todd Bodine's average was over the last seven races?
4.5.
Yeah, so just under fifth, and he's running
4.5.
Battle for fourth and fifth right now.
So about somewhere between
about
fourth
4.5.
And fifth.
Yeah, they were side by side, so I think you're right.
And Almirola, naturally, right behind Todd Bodine.
Todd Bodine, and that's the way he is in the points. 257 points separate these two as they run on the track. 13th and 14th. How about Ken Schrader back there in the 13th spot? He has David Mayhew in the 19 behind him. Again, Mayhew making his first start in the Camping World Truck Series this evening and really has put on a pretty impressive performance. Actually led a few laps.
Yeah, he's my spotlight driver from earlier. Champion last year in the K&N West Series. Excuse me. I'm sorry, that was Jason Bowes. I've been pulling for David Mayhew all night long. I'm trying to give him some championships.
But he's second this year in the points.
Yeah, he's racing for the championship this year over there. Eric Holmes has him edged out with a couple of races to go. Pretty good lead for Holmes over there in the K&N West Series.
Driving that Napa car for Bill McAnally.
There's the difference between second and third. Johnny Sauter has second. James Buescher back in third. About 3/10 of a second back.
Rick, the last time we saw these two, they were right on Austin Dillon's bumper, but they got to racing each other, and look at the distance they've lost just in a couple of laps.
Johnny Sauter, 1.8 seconds behind Austin Dillon when they crossed the stripe. When we come back, the final 18 laps from Las Vegas Motor Speedway. Stay with us. Can Dillon hang on? Final 15 laps remaining in the Smith's Food and Drug Stores 350. Into fourth goes the 88 of Matt Crafton. Todd Bodine.
They just can't settle that fourth position now between Todd and Matt Crafton. They've fought back and forth and passed each other.
Yeah, if you average Todd Bodine's running position the last five laps, it's about 4.5.
Ricky Carmichael in front of Ron Hornaday. Carmichael in the eighth spot, Hornaday ninth. Well, here comes Todd Bodine once again. He'll take fourth back.
Almost.
They
got a lap truck ahead of him. Which way is the lap truck going to go?
Looks like he's going to stay on the outside for now. At least Todd hopes so.
Worked out. Clay Greenfield took the outside. Those guys slipped to the bottom. Amarola coming with them.
Austin Dillon with a 4.5-second lead over Johnny Sauter. James Buescher back there 6 seconds behind Dillon. In the third spot, Bodine and Crafton fourth and fifth.
Right now, Austin Dillon saying, please, no caution flags. I do not want to have to go through another restart.
Almirola runs sixth. Brian Eichler is seventh.
There usually is a caution flag, though. You ever notice that?
Yeah, especially when you don't want one. And then conversely, when you want one, you can never get one.
13 laps remain. Sauter running the 13th. We're down to 12 now, running in the second spot. Those Johnny Sauter, but hasn't been able to gain on Austin Dillon. Now it's 5 seconds, the difference between Dillon and Sauter at the front of the field. This is still a great battle, fourth, fifth, and sixth. Todd Bodine has fourth, Crafton fifth, and Almirola in sixth.
If Todd can hang in here and get a top five finish, whether it's fourth or fifth, quite frankly, he knows that Eric Almirola right now, his closest pursuer, is behind him. It's just another nail in the coffin of that championship.
Check out this battle. We've got Justin Lofton slipping up on the back of Ron Hornaday. Ricky Carmichael running along that eighth spot. It's good to see Ricky having a good night. He's run so well this year at times and just seems to have a lot of problems getting to the checker. And still a little ways to go here, but solidly running ahead of Hornaday.
Justin Lofton, too, has really gotten stronger as this year's progressed.
Carmichael's best run in a truck has been fourth at this racetrack. A year ago, he finished 22nd, so looking to improve on that tonight.
You know, Carmichael gets his equipment from the same place Hornaday gets his, and for Carmichael to be able to hold off Ron like that, I know it's got to be a real vote of confidence for him. Makes him feel like he's gaining on this, learning how to race these trucks.
Impressive pass by Justin Lofton. He goes by the four-time series champion.
Lofton's using a really high line up the hill quite a lot and making it work.
Yeah, the last seven races for Justin Lofton, the only finish outside 11th was a 20th place finish. So six top 11s out of the last seven for Justin.
Is there a stat for top 11s?
I think so.
There didn't used to be top 11s when I started. You either got a top 5 or a top 10, but now we're going to break it on down as far as we can.
We're going just a position further. We've got top 11s. Austin Dillon with an impressive run once again. This time it's at Las Vegas Motor Speedway after winning the pole as the youngest pole winner at Las Vegas, as well as getting his fifth pole. And that's the first time that's ever been done by a rookie. Todd Bodine making the move by Jennifer Joe in the 10. Still in front of that 88 of Matt Crafton. But Austin Dillon now with a 6-second lead over Johnny Sauter. Once he got out front, he has been the strongest truck tonight.
Yeah, it's those guys can hang with him for a few laps, but once Sauter and Buescher started running around, trying to get around each other, racing each other, Austin drove off, and they hadn't seen him since.
Todd sneaking down the straightaway, trying to make sure that Matt Crafton cannot draft off him.
Again, these three trucks, you see Crafton going all the way down to the apron, trying to cut this track as short as he can.
He's trying to take a shortcut there, wasn't he?
He did.
You can see how good Almirola's truck sticks on the bottom of the track. He was able to close right up on the back of Matt Crafton.
Are you talking about the snake around the racetrack? Devine fourth, Crafton fifth, Almirola sixth. Good runs for all these trucks tonight, but just not enough for Austin Dillon. Austin Dillon has been so strong.
And it continues that time by, Rick. He was a couple of tenths of a second faster than anybody on the whole track.
Coming down to five to go when he gets back to the start-finish line.
Already Austin has led 87 laps of the 146 scheduled. We've completed 140.
I think that means he's going to lead the most laps.
He definitely has that locked up, so he'll gain those extra 5 bonus points.
Right now he's being shown gaining 2 positions in the points as they run now all the way up to the 4th position.
Been a little bit of a rough week on Grandpa. Richard Childress Racing had a penalty up there at Loudon, and I know it's been a tough week for Richard and that whole team. This is great medicine for him to be able to see how good his grandson's running, but even this whole team, you know, the truck team that he's put together, it's great to have this kind of night for him.
They've had a lot of success this year in Austin Dillon's rookie season in the Camping World Truck Series, getting his first win in his rookie year at Iowa earlier this year. 5 poles for the young man. Here's a great battle, still for 8th and 9th as we have just 4 laps to go.
Great to see those two young men, Ricky Carmichael and Justin Lofton, having good runs here up in the top 10.
Carmichael in the 8th spot. Lofton has been on the move, trying to take that away from Ricky Carmichael. The laps are winding down, though. You see a little bit of damage to the left front of Lofton's number 7.
Yeah, when Lofton was catching Carmichael, he was running the top, and Ricky was down low. Phil, looks like Ricky saw that in the mirror and moved his line a little bit, went up and took that groove away, and it must be working because Lofton was gaining on him quickly, and now Ricky's held that challenge off.
Final 5 miles of racing under that now, as we have under 3 laps to go for Austin Dillon. Johnny Sauter back there almost 7 seconds. James Buescher in 3rd comfortably over Todd Bodine in 4th. Crafton and Almirola, those two are separated by 3/10 of a second. We see that battle going on for the 5th position. Just 2 laps of racing remain.
Yeah, Austin Dillon would love to get to this start finish line without the caution flag coming out. That means the next flag will end this race.
We talked about Richard Childress liking what he was seeing and what good medicine this is for him. NASCAR fans everywhere like seeing that black number 3 truck out on the track, and to take a checkered flag makes them feel good too.
White flag in the air. Austin Dillon will receive it. He has a mile and a half to go from Las Vegas.
What an outstanding job this young man has done, really, this entire season, but just may, if he can go another half a lap, put win number 2 in the books.
Man, that run he had last week in Loudon, being able to rebound from a truck he didn't like all the way to a top 5 finish, and that's propelled him here. What do we got off turn 4? We
got a spinner off of 4.
Spinner off turn number 4. That's where Austin Dillon is coming through. He slows as that truck clears him, and the checkered flag will fly. Austin Dillon wins in Vegas.
Good thing he had that big lead, Phil.
Sure is, because he had to slow down for Mario Gosselin.
In the 12 was the one who spun off of turn number 4. Sauter coming home 2nd, Buescher 3rd, Bodine, Crafton, Almirola, Brian Eichler, Lofton, Carmichael, and Schrader in the top 10.
Kenny Schrader again with a top 10 finish. Every time he steps in that KHI truck, he comes home with a top 10 finish.
Bodine's going to improve his average now as he finished 4th. So he'll probably bring it down to, what, about 4.4?
4.45.
Probably, yeah, for his average finish. But how about Austin Dillon? A dominant performance. He took 1 lap in qualifying earlier, got on the pole, and now led the most laps, and he'll head to victory lane. Before we see him in victory lane, let's go to Adam Alexander.
And let's hear from his crew chief, Danny Stockman. I know it's not easy from your perspective, but there were a lot of moments tonight where that truck made it look like it was easy.
Yeah, it's definitely not easy in the Camping World Truck Series here. It's just so tough calling these short races, and you don't have very many opportunities to mess up. If you mess up one time, you're not going to finish where you need to, and it's just all these guys at RCR and this whole team here, they're just awesome, man. I just can't say enough for Austin and Andy Houston and Scott Nassett, just all these guys. They've been working so hard for this, and it's a pretty awesome deal here.
1-0 at Vegas. Congratulations.
Yeah, pretty awesome. Thank you very much.
Austin Dillon, he is headed to victory lane and celebrating in front of this crowd. A great crowd here tonight.
Yeah, and they loved it. Just like I said, they loved seeing that truck and that young man right there taking the checker flag.
Look at that smile on his face.
Back to victory lane goes Austin Dillon, 20 years old. What a night for this young man.
And Monday he can go back to college.
And Monday head back to class. Kim Lopez giving him the checkered flag. His team celebrating on pit road with him. He acknowledges him. The fireworks in the background. We saw fireworks on the racetrack. Austin Dillon, as we heard Adam talk, at times made it look easy on the racetrack, how dominant he was. But it was the restarts that Austin Dillon won this race with. Spectacular shows when you're in Las Vegas, and how about the fireworks display after Austin Dillon dominates from Las Vegas Motor Speedway? The eruptions over this mile and a half racetrack that now Austin Dillon can claim on his resume as making it to victory lane. And the guy that came oh so close, Ray Dunlap, is with Johnny Sauter.
Yeah, and a year ago, Sauter was in victory lane, but after listening to today's practice in the bright sunshine, I never thought this truck would be that good. A fourth place qualifying and second in the race. You happy with that?
You have no faith or what?
You weren't very good in practice.
Nah, I mean, that's all in the eye of the beholder, I guess. You know what I mean? I know what I got to have underneath these trucks, and Joe just kept working all day. So super proud of our farmpaint.com curb record Chevy. I mean, we got caught in gear there. I couldn't get out of fourth gear, so for whatever reason. But nonetheless, solid night. Proud of everybody at Thor Sport, and just proud to be in a Chevrolet and make the best cars and trucks on the road.
Okay, good run for Johnny Sauter. Now let's go to victory lane and Adam Alexander.
Earlier today, Austin Dillon set a rookie record for poles in the Camping World Truck Series. Tonight, he gets the trophy he was really after. Career win number 2, and he gets it in Sin City, Las Vegas. We know how happy you were to get that first career victory at Iowa, so how does this one feel?
Just that much better, man. Anytime you're in victory lane, it's awesome. These guys are they're the bomb. I can't say anything else about them, man. Bass Pro Shop Tracker Boat Chevy was awesome tonight. And I got to thank the Lord first. Without him, none of us would be here. And my mom, too, she helped me out, and it was her birthday tomorrow, so that's a good birthday present for her. And I love you, Mom. Love you, Dad, everybody back at home, family, and let's go celebrate. We're in Vegas, baby.
Now, how about those restarts late? Outside lane, lost the lead. Outside lane, lost the lead. Then you go to the inside, and you're able to jet out to the front. What happened there?
You know, James, at the beginning of the race, he was laying back, so I was kind of timing it, and that's why I could get a really good restart, and then he started catching on to it, and there at the end, I just waited for him to try and do his little move there, and I was able to catch it just a little bit better, and it pulled off. These ECR engines are great, and thank Dixie Stampede also there on the truck, and everybody back at home in RCR, you guys are building awesome bodies, awesome cars, and RCR, baby, we're going to win that chase.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Austin Dillon celebrating for the second time in his career. Tonight he wins at Las Vegas.
And Adam, you mentioned winning for his second time. He's going to have to work on making sure he's got all of his equipment in the truck when he does burnouts, because he forgot his helmet on the top of his truck and it fell off when he was celebrating. But he realized it early enough. He got back out and grabbed it. The NASCAR Camping World Truck Series on Speed is brought to you by Camping World. The Camping World Destination Recreation Sweepstakes is back and better than ever. Camping World's offering more prizes and more chances to win. Visit campingworld.com and enter today. By Verizon, the network with most 3G coverage. And by Toyota. Take a look at our point standings unofficially after 20 races. Todd Bodine with a 262-point lead. What does that mean? Well,
you can make up 140 points in a race. So he has almost a two-race lead over Eric Almirola.
If somebody doesn't take him kidnapping, this championship is. He's got this baby.
Five races to go. Let's take a look at our Dodge save of the race. How about Brian Eichler and the close calls he's had this evening?
He's been a busy cat. You can see right there, that bobble with your foot flat on the floorboard, Phil, that'll get your breath, your breath away. And then there he's into the outside wall, but I don't think he ever took his foot off the floorboard. Look, he's pulling up to make a pass after hitting the wall.
Brian Eichler, that was our Dodge save of the race. We'll be back with more celebration continuing for Austin Dillon. All smiles on the 20-year-old as he makes it back to victory lane for the second time in his career in this rookie season. A very impressive rookie season he is having. Take a look at our unofficial results. Dillon, Johnny Sauter 1-2, and probably the second strongest truck tonight as we look at our Edge Products unofficial results was the 31 of James Buescher.
Yeah, and Ty Bodine gets another top five on a mile and a half, and Matt Crafton, that's his 11th top 10 in a row in the last 11 races.
Great run for Taylor Mossom. Look down there, David Mayhew and Jason Bowes, a couple of our K&N West Series drivers finishing right next to each other. And then Jeffrey Earnhardt did a spin, got a lucky dog, top 20 finish.
Good job for him, you see.
Or top 18 finish, I'm sorry.
Mike Skinner with a problem coming down the front straightaway. He and Johnny Sauter got together. Mike Skinner had a lot of damage and does not get the finish he deserves. And Rick Crawford did such a great job avoiding that incident early over off of turn number two, but fell out of this race early.
14 races have been run at this racetrack, and Rick Crawford's been in 13 of them. But Austin Dillon is in victory lane tonight. And welcome back once again to Las Vegas Motor Speedway here in Las Vegas, Nevada. Those of you on the East Coast, thanks for staying with us. It's almost midnight out there on the East Coast. What an unbelievable rookie season Austin Dillon has had in just his 20 starts, two times to victory lane.
Yeah, what a great season he's had. And he may, by the end of the year, rivals a rookie season of Kurt Busch and Carl Edwards, who had so much success in their first year.
It has been impressive. The next stop for the Camping World Truck Series, we'll have a little bit of a break. We go on October 23rd to the short track. It's Martinsville. Should be exciting door-to-door racing. The Kroger 200, that one's afternoon race, 12:30 p.m. Eastern with Chris DeVoto will all get us started. AMA Pro Racing from Birmingham's up next. Stay with us here on Speed.
In 4 weeks, the Camping World Truck Series heads to the half-mile paperclip called Martinsville Speedway. This will be the second stop for the truck convoy in Martinsville this season. In March, Kevin Harvick dominated and left the field in the dust. Will we see a repeat performance? The best of the best will bump and bang, old school style. And the only way to see it is to tune in for the setup, hosted by Chris DeVoda at 12:30 p.m. Eastern, followed by flag-to-flag coverage. Only